When did slavery become a criminal offence in England?
It was not in the 1960s. One of these odd little new Labour laws in about 1996, 7, 8.
What an odd law to outlaw slavery. Is political correctness gone mad?
Odd in the sense that it's a bit late.
Yes, that's exactly right. It was 1807 when the slave trade was ended, and then finally in 1834, it was illegal anywhere in the British Empire to own a slave. It has never been illegal to have a slave in England until April 2010. I'm saying I could have had you as a slave legally.
You mean this series, I'm finally free?
Yes!
But you know what? I mean, one of those slaves who just goes back to the master. I don't know what to do. I work for you anyway, please.
See, one thing is that there are now estimated to be 27 million people held in, essentially, in bondage, in slavery on this planet.
But the show
now,
will be over soon. More, you can go.
Yeah.
Right now?
More than there ever were in the days of cotton picking and so
27
on.
Million?
27 million.
In the world?
Yeah, that is the estimate. It's a pretty grim problem still, slavery. The point is, it was never illegal in England because it was never recognised as a state of being. There were laws against kidnapping and abduction and false imprisonment and sexual trafficking and all the other things that we might associate with slavery. But it was not illegal for one human to own another human, which it now is.
So this is a law that this isn't one of those laws where they thought, oh, that needs to clearing up. It's a loose end from history.
It kind of was. In 1967, there were a number of obsolete crimes that were taken care of. Barratry had been illegal right up to 1967, which is vexatious lawsuits.
Oh, okay.
Building of
vexatious
houses.
Lawsuits.
Yeah, what they call a vexatious litigant, somebody just keeps carrying.
Dorothy Squires.
Yes.
Dorothy Squires, the singer Dorothy Squires, towards the end of her life when she did have a mania, but she was probably the last person to be done for vexatious litigant.
And if you kept prosecuting someone for it, you'd be prosecuting them.
Yourself?
Yeah, well, it's completely. Anyway, there's scolding. Scolding was a crime in 1966, but not in 1967.
With hot water, you mean?
Not scolding. Scolding.
No.
Scolding!
That was a crime.
You! What time of the night do you call this, Eddie Izzard?
12.
Yes.
12:30.
Well, they give you a good scolding.
And that was illegal?
That was illegal.
Illegal.
Yeah.
And that was legal?
Eavesdropping was illegal. Challenging someone to a fight was also illegal until 1967.
What about going round and round and round about more than three times?
It certainly wouldn't have been a medieval law, would it?
Well, I don't know. And if you had a horse and cart, you had a couple of hours spare.
On a medieval roundabout,
On a medieval roundabout.
Yes. Anyway, there you are. Due to a quirk of English law, it only became a criminal offence to keep a slave in the year 2010. So you've just... Now, which popular game traditionally ends with all the players being thrown into a lake of fiery sulphur?
Well, I hope it's show jumping. I hate show jumping. I'd have one of those after every jump.
Before and after every jump.
Yeah.
It's not show jumping, though. It would certainly liven it up.
It sounds biblical.
I don't think it's the humans, though. It's pieces. Wouldn't it be pieces?
Well, I'll tell you that it's a game that went dramatically out of fashion in 1972. Early 72, it was more popular than Monopoly. But by the end of 72, it had almost completely gone out of fashion because of a film.
Mousetrap. Mousetrap.
No, there is no film of
because
Mousetrap.
Of a film. Is it Drafts? Remember that film? Drafts.
The film's true.
The truth about Drafts.
No.
Drafts makes you go bald. Don't play Drafts.
The film is not a game, there's a game in it.
A game in
this game is played in it and it's scary.
Oh, is it a seance?
Yeah, it is a seance using a Ouija board.
Okay. Right.
And what film has there a Ouija board?
The Exorcist
is the right answer. One of the truly great films of the 20th century.
Is a Ouija board really a game? I don't remember ever seeing Ouija board scenes in a film and at the end going, right, who won?
Well, the odd thing about Ouija, it was a board, it still belongs to Parker Brothers.
Get out!
Ouija is a proprietary name, it's trademark.
Is it Ouija?
Interesting point. That is some people's theory of the name of it. It has two words for yes, Ouija, the French, and Ya, the German. But no one's quite sure about where the name came from, except that it's a game that was invented. The board was invented and it was sold and people played it. I mean, it's weird to say that, but they enjoyed the fact that it nearly always works in as much as, you know, people spell out words and they don't quite know how they're doing it. It's clearly not dead people.
Yeah.
And in fact, it was not originally supposed to be dead people. It was supposed to be that you contacted yourselves, a part of yourselves that automatically wrote. It was not about seances.
Dead people just joined in. This is good. Yeah. This is the one for us.
Yeah. Even when recently asked, only a third of the people who still use Ouija boards say they do it to contact dead people. And in the First World War, it was used to contact your troops abroad, supposedly.
So hold on. Are some dead people trying to communicate with the living through Monopoly?
Yeah. There was a court case in the 90s, I'm sorry to say, in Britain, a murder case, quite an important one, and the jury had to be dismissed because in their hotel overnight, they used a Ouija board to try and contact the murdered person. And apparently the murdered person said, the guy in the dock is guilty, convict him. Really? And said, the judge heard about it and dismissed the jury, quite rightly, you may say. But the awful thing was, if they'd done it in the jury room, the judge couldn't have dismissed them. Because the judge has no right in law to know what goes on in a jury room. The deliberations must be private.
Unless he's dead.
Yeah, that's really complicated. Yeah.
Was the guy guilty?
Unfortunately, he was retried and found guilty, which sort of is really irritating. So maybe the ghost of the murdered person did.
Where's the competitive element?
I suppose you just have a go.
Yeah.
Who are you trying to contact? Right, it's your turn.
Yeah, exactly.
Or you contact two dead people and then they box. Tell you how it went. Ghost boxing. Ghost boxing. On Sky Sports 2. Live ghost boxing from Auntie Vera's parlour. That's it, people in sheets.
Yeah.
The hitless man, he's already down. It's just going like that. It's kind of punchy.
Do you know there's an Elvis?
Yeah. Here we go. Go on. Hit me.
There's an Elvis seance website.
Of course there is. I bet there's more than one of those.
Where you contact Elvis.
Online?
But it cautions... it cautions, if you wish to repeat this experiment, please be considerate. Many people may wish to contact Elvis, and we're sure he's quite busy. Please treat this information...
For eternity.
Yes. Please treat this information the same as you would if he were alive and you had his email address. With respect. It's a terrifying thought, isn't it? A sort of posthumous Twitter and things like that. That would be hell, I have to say.
Have you just thought of that?
Yeah.
You're in it up to your neck.
Oh, God. Horrifying. But the reference in the Bible to the fiery lake or whatever is from Revelations, where it does say those who practice the magic arts will be cast into burning sulfur.
So... How about balloon animals?
Ooh, the punishment for people who do balloon animals is not specified in Revelations.
I think it's loneliness, the punishment for them.
Long nights, sitting alone.
So, yeah, in my youth, games which conjured up the spirits of the dead were a popular gift for children, it's a weird thought. Why are so many great men short?
Are they really?
David, you've hit the nail on the head. Rem acu tetigisti, as they would say in Latin.
I'm sure they would.
Yeah.
It means nice one, son.
Yeah. That's absolutely right. In fact, Napoleon
was short, wasn't he?
No, he was above average height.
Everyone was short in those
wasn't
days.
Wasn't he? He was 5 foot six, which is taller than
he was.
He
was 5'7", actually. Average height was about 5'6"-ish.
So it's just the British who decided he was short. Put him down a bit.
Yes. It was particularly a cartoonist called Gilray. When we were at war with Napoleon, there was a famous one of George III with a little Napoleon based on Gulliver's Travels, like that. Ah. And he's actually saying, I cannot but conclude you to be one of the most pernicious little odious reptiles that nature ever suffered to crawl upon the surface of the earth.
It's a snappy one.
He was 3 inches taller than Nelson, for example. Nelson was 3 inches shorter than Napoleon. It's certainly true that
Nelson was 5 foot four.
Yeah.
Like Danny DeVito.
He was very, short chap.
No wonder they put him on such a big
column. Is that kind of...
Yes, he's tall in Trafalgar Square.
Is that short man syndrome a kind of retrospective thing, then, that we've kind of invented more recently and then just gone back and said they're all short?
Yeah. Some of them were short, though. There's no question. I mean, Stalin was surprisingly short. He was only 5'5". Mussolini was 5'6". Franco was 5'4".
5'4"?
Yeah.
They are all short, Steve.
Well, no. Hit the 5'8". Idi Amin was 6'4".
Yeah, big
fella. That's my height. Mm. Fidel Castro, 6'1". Mao was 5'9", which is rather tall for a Chinese person.
Mm.
So...
But mostly they're not judged on their height, are they?
No. They're not. They're not. But all I'm...
We'll let that go.
Yeah. All I'm saying, there seems to be historically no evidence that short people are more power-hungry, more tyrannical than people of average or tall stature.
Because you're right, it came about, though, because it's just that one... It's probably the one thing that short people have got to cling on to. One day, they might be a dictator.
Well,
and we've just taken that away from them.
All this,
a little hope.
All this not being able to reach things from shelves, one day will be made up for when I kill millions of people. And I can stand on their bodies.
Yeah.
Reach the jam.
Yeah. Everybody knows somebody short in their life who's been particularly angry and abused his position of authority. And then you decide he's a bit like Hitler.
That's the point. You notice when a short man has a tantrum and says, oh, short man, Napoleon complex.
Tall man has a tantrum, you just leg it.
Exactly. Yeah. I have to say, I'm rather shocked by this. Heightism does exist. Short people are paid less on average than tall people. The disparity is comparable in magnitude to race and gender. A survey of Fortune 500 companies...
They should rise up.
Yeah. Hey. The chief executive officers of Fortune 500 companies, 90% are above average height. Which is astounding, really. And 30% of those are over 6'2". You're the tallest 4%.
Every now and again, a little short fella breaks through.
Yeah. Oh, stop.
Escapes, gets away.
Yeah.
But it is.
It is rather shocking that there is this disparity. And of course, we always notice the powerful, short, rich man with a young, tall wife is
billionaire Bernie Eccleston. She's actually, I've seen her with him. She's actually much taller than that. Above him.
Yeah, she's bending her knee there.
Yeah. I mean, he has to jump up to slap her on the bum. He can run through her legs.
And who's the couple on the left?
That's Carla Bruni and...
Sarkozy. But at least the women have both got handbags that their husbands can fit in.
No, there isn't really any evidence that dictators are shorter than the rest of us, the Napoleon complex. Now, Alan, why will you never eat my noodles?
It was bound to happen that this show would just become about you two.
just haven't agreed on a fee, have you?
Do you remember we're involving people from countries beginning with K?
Kenya.
Well, which have a particular association perhaps with noodles.
Kent.
Famous for the Kentish pasta. Go east.
Korea.
Thank you, Josh. In Korea, noodles, of course, are very popular.
Of course.
And when will I eat your noodles means when are you getting married? In other words, when are you going to be throwing a party in which you will serve noodles? So it's just a Korean phrase. It's like saying, when are you going to tie the knot?
Ah.
When am I going to eat your noodles? Well, you're already married, so I'm not going to eat your noodles. And you didn't invite me.
I did invite you.
Oh, you didn't. No, that's right. I was abroad.
Yeah, you know what you were doing? You were filming an episode of Bones.
Yes, I was.
I've always so insulted in my life.
I'm so sorry. Oh, God, how embarrassing. I'm so sorry. Anyway, that's what it means. Here are some other Korean phrases, though. The other man's rice cake always looks bigger.
What?
Be the British equivalent of that.
The grass is always greener.
Or as my uncle used to say, the other man's arse is always cleaner. If there are too many ferrymen on a boat, it will sail up a mountain.
Is that just literal?
Probably, maybe.
If they say that in North Korea, the boat is going up the mountain.
That's true. There is
too many cooks spoil the broth.
Too many cooks spoil the broth.
So, Stephen, tell me about your childhood.
Okay, here's one. He worked as if he were tending the grave of his wife's uncle.
That's brilliant.
What would that mean?
I might start using that.
Not much.
Yes is the answer, because in Korea, it is your duty to tend the graves of your family. But the more distant the family, the less attention you give the grave. So all he was doing was just basically sprinkling a little bit of water on the... It's only his wife's uncle. Whereas his grandfather, his father, or his mother, he'd be putting flowers and being with great attention. So that's
so
what
like
that means.
Shagging the dog.
Not really. Not really, Catherine. Is there something you want to share with us? Right? Shagging the dog.
Yeah, like if you don't work very hard, you're just shagging the dog.
Not in this country, madam. In this country, when we shag a dog, we know what we're doing. Pretty hard work.
Not as easy as it looks, I tell you that.
So in Canada, you have the phrase shagging the dog.
Yeah. Wow. Or like shagging the sheep if you want. Whatever.
That's not funny.
Again, perfectly common practice over here, but not considered a light or unburdensome task.
It just means like having an easy day.
There's a lot I have to learn about Canada.
It's easy because with, like, a lady, you have to take her out to dinner or woo her a bit, but with the dog, it's just like, here, boy, come on.
You say that. You say that.
Yeah, what? He's here. Most of the work is still to be done in that situation.
Yes. I'm thinking, oh, let's move on. So, showing off your wrinkles to a silkworm?
You have found a silkworm in your underpants.
Silkworms are pretty wrinkly. Ooh. So if you show your wrinkles to a silkworm, he's going to go, nah, I can do better than that. So it's like teaching your grandmother to suck eggs.
Oh,
it's,
that's imagine how wrinkly a silkworm's knackers are.
And finally, he disappeared like a fart through hemp pajamas.
That one speaks for itself, doesn't it?
It's a Korean phrase. Awkwardly, basically. Embarrassingly, awkwardly, not with maximum grip.
And there are lots of words called orphaned negative. So these are words that have the opposites, but nobody uses them. They're now obsolete. So what would be the opposite of ineffable?
Effable.
Effable, but nobody ever uses it as a perfectly good word, isn't
it? I've heard people say that.
Effable's not effable.
Oh, he's got nice trousers on today. He's totally effable.
Yeah, well, funny, and thank you. I really appreciate it. They're very roomy.
No, there are lots of good ones. Incessant. So, cessant, nobody talks about cessant anymore. Well, this is the weird thing about this word, OK? What it tells you in the dictionary is that cessant hasn't been used since 1701. What happened that year? They thought, you know, I'm done with that word.
What about disdain?
Oh, yes, because the opposite of being a good Dane. Yes, yeah. A disdain.
Disdain.
Yeah. Nocent? Anybody?
Yesent.
Innocent. Yeah, nocent was a criminal.
Innocent.
Until about the 17th century, so nocentum, Latin meaning to harm.
Is nonchalant?
Chalant.
Chalant.
Yes. I'm going to refer to you as chalant. I like that. I think that sounds rather good.
Yeah,
chalant and effable.
Stopping you.
To be fair, Jimmy, I had to have it pointed out to me.
Oh, I hate the inflammable and flammable.
Mm. Same thing.
It is exactly the same thing. It's not an orphan negative at all. In fact, the opposite of flammable is non-flammable.
Explosive.
I beg your pardon?
Just reading.
Oh, explosive. OK, used to be inflammable because it comes from the Latin inflammare, but they adopted flammable deliberately in the 20th century because, honestly, inflammable seemed ambiguous, so that is one of the reasons why we now say flammable and then non-flammable.
Right.
Anybody know what a contronym is?
Oh, so it's like, so it's got synonym?
Yeah.
Antonym.
Antonyms, yes. So it's a word that is also its own opposite. So screen, which means to show, like screen a film, and screen also to means to hide. Another example, bound, so fastened to the spot and also heading somewhere.
Oh, that's good.
They're good, aren't they? Nice. Contronyms. See, you like this? Fast, so moving quickly, and stuck and unable to move.
And also, I always thought with fast food, the fastest not to eat, and then also to eat loads really cheaply.
Yeah, there you go.
I think we may need marijuana for this. Yeah. It seems to me like this should be a conversation that happens at, like, yeah, man, fast.
Yeah. No, man, fast food.
I love that your impression of someone on drugs means you've never taken them.
Antigram. Does anybody know what an antigram is?
It is the opposite of a gram.
So these are words where if you do an anagram, the anagram itself has the opposite meaning to the original word. So
impossible.
Yeah. Dormitories, tidier rooms is one. There's one. Customers, I like this one. The anagram is store scum. Oh, is
that... There's a few people out there working retail.
Here's another one, an antigram. A volunteer fireman, I never run to a flame. And 45 is an anagram of over 50. It's just a woman lying, basically. Let's try a parlour game to get us started. One Victorian parlour game was called Taboo. You were asked a question and had to answer without using a taboo letter of the alphabet. Our taboo letter tonight is obviously N, so please answer the following questions without using the letter N. Matt? Name a tasty yellow fruit grown mostly in the Caribbean and Central America. In the Philippines, its name has been corrupted to bayabas.
Is it, a ba-a-a? I'm trying to think what's nice and yellow. Crisps. I'm going for crisps.
It's a tasty yellow fruit.
Yeah.
So, no, the answer is guava. Is the answer we were
looking
for.
Oh, there is an answer.
There is an answer.
I've been playing this game wrong for years.
It isn't banana at all. The answer is guava is the fruit that we were looking for. In the Philippines, it has been corrupted to bayabas. Do you know what the Filipinos call bananas?
No.
They call them bananas. I could have got you with that one, had you fallen for it. Susan, what do you call a woman who looked after Victorian children whose mothers were social equals but couldn't be asked to do the job themselves?
Well, I would call them the help.
Which is nice, but not the correct term.
Well, then I would call them... You've got such a gaze, Sandy. It's like the eye of Sauron.
Sorry, but Sauron's got an N in it.
I would have said the nanny or a governess. Yes. I was essentially cajoled into that.
You were. So, not nanny, obviously, because how many N's have we got there?
At least two.
At least two. Also, not socially equal, the nanny. It's au pair.
Oh, no, I almost...
Au pair, been around...
Josh, how annoying, isn't it? Start with your own. Oh, I was on the tip of my tongue there.
It's been around since the 1840s, the word au pair. Well, it literally means social equal, au pair.
Does it?
Yeah.
Have you met our social equal? She's really, really fit.
He's only run off with the social equal.
So, nobody doing very well, but I'm relying on Josh to get this one right.
Watch and learn.
OK, here we go. What do you call a Roman Catholic religious woman who has taken simple vows of poverty, chastity and obedience?
Is it the au pair?
That is guava.
Oh, it's difficult, isn't it, now?
Yeah, not so quick with the answers now. Yeah.
Tracy?
go on then. None.
None.
Yeah.
No. So here's the thing. thing. The answer is a sister. So a nun has taken solemn vows, but a sister has taken simple vows. It's a technical difference to do with the repudiation of property. So a nun's solemn vow repudiates property absolutely. A sister's simple vow allows her to reserve an interest. Edging her bets, Josh. Edging her bets, that one. Right, Alan.
Yes.
Name any of the digits in the common emergency telephone number. There's an emergency number which is
999.
Two great guys. Two great guys.
But the common emergency telephone number is 112.
Is it?
Yeah. So you can use it on a mobile phone, even if it's locked or you haven't got a SIM card.
It has got
internet. 112.
Well, I asked you to name any of the digits in the common emergency number. So you could have said two.
Oh my word.
Two.
Christmas, so Alan wins that one.
There. What were chainsaws originally invented for?
Proctology. Wow. That's scary.
Yeah, that's a...
Slicing an arse in half.
Yeah.
Well, you know, you're in the right area, I have
really?
To say.
What?
I mean,
really?
Well, circumcision.
What I mean is... You began straight away with medicine. You didn't say trees or you know, cutting down...
Oh, cutting
you know,
off legs.
Buildings. Slip bones and...
Bones is the right answer, yes. In particular, it was a rather unpleasant procedure.
Oh, don't. It'll be a boy thing against a girl thing. It
well, not against, you know.
Well, no, it's
doctors trying to help.
Oh, I know what it is. I know what it is. It'll be a boy thinking a woman's taking far too long over labour, going, oh, I can't stand all that panting. I know, we'll get a chainsaw, just cut that baby out. That's what it is.
But you know, you're absolutely right.
Oh, my God.
It was in 1783.
That's no excuse.
it was two Scots doctors called John Aitken and James Jaffrey, and it was called a symphysiotomy, and it was a procedure to widen the pelvis if the baby's head was too large to pass through.
Oh, can you hear the high tone of all those sighs?
Yeah. Like about this picture.
It's a bit eye-watering.
It's a ladies' ward, so, of course, there is some baking going on.
Yes.
On
the
display
cakes.
Hot buns in the oven, Stephen. You see what I did?
Buns in the oven.
They didn't really, darling.
I'm afraid they did. When I say chainsaw, it was literally a chain. It was like a watch chain, in fact.
Ah, right.
It was like an up and down.
It was a full lumberjack giving it... It's a boy!
They hadn't yet invented the internal combustion engine.
And caesarean sections. They
caesarean sections have replaced the same idea. That
you.
Yes, quite, exactly.
Wow,
it's a bit of a relief.
To do the caesarean section, I think. Sawing the pelvic bone in half is not as easy as maybe just a small incision. And
but is there
I know, you'd have thought they would have
popped out the sunroof.
But this was before, it was before antiseptic surgery, and of course it was before any kind of anaesthetic.
They're not a meeting. You know what I mean? There's not a meeting where someone goes, I've got it. And they go, what? They go, chainsaw, innit?
Well, they looked at a watch chain and they said, you know, we could sort of ease away the bone like that rather than using a saw. I know, everyone's wincing.
Have we got another question that isn't about that?
Would it heal? Presumably not very well.
Well, they then went on to use the same thing. For example, if someone had a bit of diseased bone, they would do the same thing. They would sort of tick it in, then they'd go up and down like that, and then they'd do it lower down, and the two bits would fuse together and have a stiff arm. But it would get rid of the diseased bone. It was called an osteotome. It eventually became like a chainsaw. You can see one here. That is more like a chainsaw. Pretty unpleasant.
You don't want that coming at you.
You really don't. No. You really, really don't.
I remember my wife had a baby. I remember it well. And, it was a grand day. But when she had a baby, and there's a point where you go in to see the fella who's going to sort it out on the day. That's him. Yeah, he's got an official title. And and you go and see him. And as the husband, he says, right, you sit there on a chair. And then he pulls the curtain across. Yes. While him and your wife are in this thing, while he has a little dabble or
it's
whatever he's doing.
It's a bit intimate, isn't it?
It's a bit like you go, I've seen it, mate. Do you know what I mean? There's nothing. This is why we're here.
Well, you don't look when that happens, though, do you, at the moment of conception? Do you actually have a look? You're looking into it.
Surely.
Jason,
Sorry.
Stephen doesn't need to know, Jason. He doesn't need to know.
You're gazing lovingly into her eyes.
Gazing lovingly. Gazing lovingly at the Bourne identity, which is still on the television. As you reach for your drink.
I'm...
Do you think, darling, that he's got a periscope at the moment?
I'm sorry.
I don't know why you and I are having this conversation.
After the invention of the internal combustion engine, where we were getting Jeremy Day's home territory now, eventually by 1920 they were small enough to be able to have a hand-powered
cut down trees.
And then they cut down trees. Yes. Exactly. Well, anyway, there you are. Chainsaws were originally invented for midwives. Which war killed the highest proportion of British soldiers?
The American War of Independence.
Good guess.
Yeah.
English Civil War.
The English Civil War is the correct answer.
Because everybody killed in the English Civil War was British.
Well, that's absolutely right.
So they must be.
Plus, it was an exceptionally bloody conflict.
Very, very violent.
And the population of the country was quite small.
And all anybody knows about it is the hairstyles. All anybody says, oh, it's Roundheads and Cavaliers. And you think, yeah, that's it, really. One lot looks like the Grumbleweeds, the other lot like Lawrence Llewellyn Bowen, so it all kicks off. That man's got a wooden leg and riding side saddle.
Apparently, 90% of Britons cannot name a single battle of the English Civil War. 80% do not know which English king was executed by Parliament. And 67% of schoolchildren have never heard of Oliver Cromwell.
Good.
As a royalist, do you think his name should be buried?
No, he's a dreadful man. He was a truly, truly horrible, one of the most horrible people ever to have walked the land.
But you wouldn't know that if you didn't know about
it. He did terrible damage being a Puritan. He wrecked all our beautiful churches. He ripped away all the iconography and graven images and replaced them with the giant thermometers that you can still see to this day.
So how many British people died in the Civil War, then?
85,000 on the battlefield. Another 100,000 dying of their wounds afterwards. People who really suffered were the Irish, of whom it's estimated half the population were decimated by the great Cromwell. And it's an example, a friend told me, who works at the Foreign Office, that dear Robin Cook, when the Labour Party came to power and they were going to be all ethical, they were going to be all good, they took down some picture in the Foreign Office of a Nepalese prince because they thought it was all imperialist, which deeply offended the Nepalese government. And they put up this big portrait of Cromwell, you know, Republican, you know, sort of lefty figure. And the first meeting they had was with the Irish government. It took one look and it was like showing Eichmann to the Israeli ambassador. In the 7 years between 1642 and 1649, in the period known as the English Civil War, a staggering 1 in 10 of the adult male population died.
Alan, don't you not want some points or not?
Well, that's very difficult to say yes or
What do you reckon?
There's three negatives.
Ah, yes. Don't you not want some points or not? Do you not want some...
Do you not want some points?
Or not?
Do you not...
Well, we also don't know whether he does or not.
Yes.
Don't you not want some points?
Points or not?
Do not not want points.
So here's the thing.
It's true to say that I do not not want points.
Yes.
Or not
would mean that you do.
You'd say, do you want points or not?
No, yes, but...
So the answer is... Well, there's two questions.
No, it's just one question with one answer, but I just tell you now, one answer has a klaxon and one doesn't. I'm giving too much away.
Can we help him?
The show's nearly over. I'm filibustering.
Just.
You asked the question in English.
I did, yes.
English, there are 500,000 words in the Oxford English Dictionary. It is the largest language in the world.
Yes.
1,000 times no.
Oh, yes. Have you thought of that today?
Yes.
Yes is the right answer.
Right answer.
Oh,
it's not a yes-no question.
No, that's what I thought. Well,
but fundamentally, yes is better than no. Is where my head is. I was enjoying Giles's.
But curiously, the answer would have been different.
I didn't mean I'd come back to it. I wasn't enjoying it that much.
But interestingly, the answer in French would have been yes. Oh no, no.
In French, you could have said, I don't know, which is je ne sais pas, which is a double negative.
Or. But if you translate, what did you originally say?
Is it too early to lose the will to live?
I'm extremely concerned, Sandy, yes. that you,
yes.
a role model for women everywhere,
yes.
should, in fleshing out the double negative, come out with a statement broadly, yes is better than no. That's not what I'll be telling my daughter.
There's a lot of these in pop, aren't there? A lot of these in pop and rock lyrics.
Yes.
There's lots of I can't get no satisfaction.
Yes, there is. And if it's a positive double negative, like Tom Jones's It's Not Unusual, that's fine, OK?
Why is that fine?
Well, it never used to be a problem, the double negative. And then in the 18th century, they became obsessed with mathematics, and it's to do with mathematics.
Oh.
So they began to codify the language as being illogical if it didn't fit with mathematical thinking. So in mathematics, minus a minus is a plus.
Oh, do this in Danish.
OK. Yeah. So, I can do it. No, I won't do it now.
If you do that, I think I've had a stroke.
No.
I was just thinking there's a body being found.
You can almost feel the wind on the bridge.
What happened to the fireman's pole? Fire.
He tiled the fireman's bathroom.
Very good. Very good. I mean, how much time does it save to go down a pole? I mean, they've got to drive half the mile across the town anyway to get there. So
that's true.
Half a second off the... Just walk down the stairs.
Why don't they have a slide, like in the park?
Oh, that would be fun.
You could have a swirly slide or even a water slide.
It'd be a good way of getting young firemen in, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Getting them trained. It was probably a health and safety thing, I would imagine.
Oh, God.
Is it really?
No, you see,
health and safety. That's the new political correctness gone mad.
Yeah, there were a series of stories in the newspapers that, like, essentially just to make things up, in order to get us all angry in the morning, they claimed that, you know, firemen's poles were being taken out because health and safety. And it's just
it's the whole reason.
I mean, most new fire stations are built on one floor, so they don't arise. Yeah. But in all ones where they exist, they're there. And if they build one with two floors, they get their poles.
But surely that's the main reason you become a fireman, isn't it?
Yeah.
You go down the pole. It's not like I want to be a fireman so that I might die in a fire.
Yes.
It's I want to go down the pole and maybe one night I'll bring a special friend back and share with the pole and...
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
You demand an extra floor on the fire station. That's my story and I'm sticking to it. So
no, do you know where the longest pole is in Europe, fireman's pole? And how long would you think it might be? What's the maximum length?
48 feet, I would guess.
64 feet.
No, 40 foot, actually. There's a 40-footer in Birmingham and it's the biggest in Europe.
That's the limit, is it?
There may be a bigger one in America, terrifying. I believe.
That's really quite high.
It is quite high, 40 foot, yeah.
And you're really going to take the skin off your hands by the time you get off.
So, you picture that squeaky noise and it makes your teeth go on edge.
They tail up like the weightlifters.
They should do, shouldn't they?
Do they teach a technique of coming down the pole? Just hands? Because they all seem to be doing...
I think the thighs have to exert pressure.
I must say, they're a hell of a lot of firefighters.
The driver of the fire engine is there going, no, I can't go yet, I've got to wait for all the... Meanwhile, a whole family is burning to death.
Well, apparently it's because they sometimes literally are still pulling on their trousers and they're running downstairs doing that. Of course, is much more dangerous than going down a pole where you can just sort of hold them up and go down the pole and put them on. You really are, and obviously every second can save a life.
I don't understand why the firemen are always completely caught out by the fact that...
What? A fire?
Oh, my God!
Quick! All undressed.
Were the poles always made of shiny metal? Or were there early versions that splintered and...
Oh, nasty.
Well, they must have experimented with
flammable
materials.
Pole, that'd be absurd. They'd all be stuck up there with the pole on fire. Nowhere to put it out.
It was insurance companies invented firemen.
You're absolutely right. I think you should get some points for that, Clive, because you're completely correct. Things like the Sun was one of the biggest, now the Royal Sun Alliance. That started as a fire insurance company. And what would happen was you'd pay the insurance to the company and they would send you a brass plaque which you would set into the wall of your house. So if there was a fire, What tended to happen was lots of different brigades came from different insurance companies and they read the plaque, and if you hadn't paid, they wouldn't put your fire out. Unless you happened to be next to someone else who had. Because, you know, if you got a fire, the chances are the fire would spread to them.
I think that's one of the worst things I can imagine, is your house is on fire and they turn up and won't put it out.
I know, can you imagine that?
That would make me annoyed.
Would they stay and kind of roast marshmallows, or would they just drive straight up?
I'd stand there with the hose going,
Or sort of saying...
stand there with water pouring out the other
way. Since we're here, if you paid for the next time, we might as well collect now.
Think again with your premiums.
It's not the fire that kills people. I don't know if you're aware of this.
Fire doesn't kill people.
No. Well, what it does, Clive, of course. You're not going to tie me up in legalese here. I'm not going to get all heated up, which is what you want to happen. I'm not going to stay very calm.
He didn't say fire doesn't kill people. He said it's not the fire that kills people.
Your lordship is absolutely right. Thank you. But I was just exploring a bit of this. The notion that fire was in some way not deadly.
It's not the fire that kills the people.
Generally
it's
speaking.
A byproduct of the fire. And I wonder if any of you know what that byproduct is.
Is it flame?
Is it the slinky? Yeah.
It's not the slinky, Stephen, but it's a
wild
try.
Yeah.
Clive, you were right. Smoke. It's the smoke. And what happens is, smoke doesn't burn you, so I know what you're thinking. Well, how on earth could... No. What smoke does, and this is where it gets interesting, chokes you. And if we choke, what can't we do?
Breathe. We can't breathe.
No. We can't breathe. We can't breathe. What do, Dom?
We die.
Yes.
What kind of animal can you eat without killing it? Rich.
Crabs, unintentionally. In the south.
Yeah.
In the deep south, in the bayou. On the bayou. Freshwater mussels, they just pick them right out of the water, and they'll have these tiny pink crabs crawling on them, and they're considered a delicacy. And they're alive. They're alive when you swallow them.
These are things you can eat fully, an animal food stuff, but you don't kill the animal.
So it's something that sort of comes through like sweet corn, except it's still running around. You see?
No. No, I'm not saying it passes through the entire digestive system.
Right,
no.
Oh, right.
No, no.
But it stays in you and this sets up a community.
Whatever they put in Yakult. They wither on about that, don't they?
Yes, bifidus digestivum. Or L-Cassia immunitas.
How stupid do they think we are?
Don't you know these things? I'm so impressed.
Well, as I spend a lot of time watching television, and listening to the new made-up science is very entertaining.
I love the made-up science where they go, do you want to buy a tiny pot of off-milk?
Yeah. Yes! And they say it's always such a good deal. Just try it for 9 weeks. And then if you don't feel better, then give up. Because actually, if everyone tries it for 9 weeks, we're in the money.
No, because, I mean, actually, in a sense, you're probably right about bacteria, which would possibly pass through us and all the way and not be killed. But this is actually a delicacy. I'm inclined to give the point to Rich because he's sort of accidentally right, only he's.
As usual.
Wrong as well.
It's not a joy in my life.
It's one of the most popular foods, almost the national dish in some ways, of Florida.
Tapeworm.
Not tapeworm. No, it's a type of crab. It's a stone crab.
Oh, right.
Stone crab claws are very popular. There is a stone crab. And the fishermen catch the crab, they snap off the claws and throw the crab back in. And it takes about a year for its claws to grow back. But it is considered a great delicacy, usually served with a sort of butter and mustard sauce. Very popular, indeed, in restaurants up and down America, but particularly, as I say, in Florida.
What does it do for a year, then, armless down, wandering about?
He's up to himself.
The crab is dismayed when it loses its claws, thinking, now I can't get any work done. All that stuff, I'm trying to rearrange the seabed. It'll be a year before I can do any of that. I'm just going to have to lay up. It's almost like they're sort of fruit-bearing animals, aren't they?
That's pretty similar to that, exactly. Yeah. Like an apple tree has its apples taken off, but the next year it grows more apples.
So maybe they're trees. They're just seafoody trees.
Yeah.
They can walk around.
Same DNA.
You could have given me as an answer as well, there are certain tribesmen in the Masai Mara in northern Tanzania and Kenya who will drink the blood of cattle. You know, not kill them, but sort of slit the throat a bit, drink the blood, mix it with milk, actually. And then they bind up the wound again, and so they don't kill
the cow, but that practice is dying out a bit.
They mix it with milk, so they think that cattle have two drinks.
You can have one or the other, or a mixture of the two.
Fantastic, these two drink animals.
Anyway, stone crabs it is. They're returned to the sea alive and their claws have been taken off. Over the next year, they grow a replacement, although it's never quite as good as the first one.
What is the most mysterious thing you do in bed?
You regrow, you regenerate your body parts, don't you?
OK,
at night. That's what I call it, anyway. What are you doing in there? I'm regenerating!
Do you mean that there are bits that are broken? You mend them, is that what you mean?
Don't you grow a new liver every 7 years or something? There's no bit of you that is actually the age that you are.
No, I think it's every 10 years you're a totally new
person.
You're
totally new, bones,
yes,
everything.
No,
you don't grow gums back. Gums recede and they don't come back. You can't go, oh, I think I'm going to grow my gums long this year.
It's probably quite good that the gums don't keep growing and growing and growing. Yeah. Imagine having to get them trimmed. That's going to be an extremely bloody... Yeah.
What do you do for a living? I'm a gum dresser.
Yeah. You have to get head to toe in plastic, like CSI, when someone comes in for a long overdue gum trimming.
You have to show them the back of their gums.
Yeah.
So, the most thing that we do in bed, all of us...
Dreaming.
Breathing.
It's sleeping. We have no idea. It is the most mysterious thing that we do in bed because we just don't know why we do it. Why would you end the day unconscious and basically paralysed and leave yourself available to attack by predators unless there is some fantastic evolutionary benefit that outweighs the risk? And the fact is, we just don't know. People have thought it was to do with energy conservation.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous because you actually don't save much energy.
Really?
No, not when you sleep, no.
How many days can you go without sleep for before you die?
If you stay awake for 17 hours, it's the same as having two glasses of wine in terms of how it would affect your performance.
Red wine or white wine? If it's white wine, then I'll just start crying.
Oh, would you? Oh, you're bad drunk.
Yeah, I'd never once drunk more than two glasses of white wine and not used the phrase, why don't you just dump me, Ben?
Even to people who you're not in a relationship.
Not even. No, you save about 110 calories each night, so a two-finger Kit Kat is 107. It's not a lot, is it?
That's the only energy saving.
That's the only energy saving.
So when you wake up in the morning, you can have a two-finger Kit Kat?
Help yourself.
Gratis.
Yeah, it totally wipes it all out, frankly.
It's a classy breakfast.
Yes!
Quiet one!
So the theory that I like best, there have been some scientists at the University of Rochester Medical Center in New York, and they think it's when our brains are cleaned. There's a professor, Maiken Nithergawk, and she says you can think of it like having a house party. You can either entertain the guests or clean up the house, but you can't really do both at the same time. That's the theory. But how much you sleep depends on your own circadian rhythm. So I didn't sleep very much. Are you, anybody here a good sleeper?
I've got a five-month-old baby, so I only sleep in hour-and-a-half chunks at the moment.
So if you just come for a break just tonight...
This is the best thing that's ever happened to me.
Are you a good sleeper now? Do you sleep well?
Yeah, I can sleep a lot, yeah.
Apparently what you should do to find out how much you need to sleep is you should spend a week not having an alarm clock at all, and you should let your body just wake up when it needs to and log how many hours, and if you need 6 hours and you need to get up at 7 a.m, then you know what time you've got to go to bed.
But Sandy, you need a wee at 5.
Yes.
No matter what.
Yeah, it's very annoying. Yeah. And it's not like you particularly have that much wee to do.
You get there and you think, why have you woken me up for that? I would rather have just left that in the bed. We could have just done it.
Also, sometimes, in the middle of the night you can start thinking about something stressful or get frightened by noises in the house.
Yeah. Would you believe that they put a man on the moon?
Who? Hey, these guys.
NASA.
Oh, NASA. Yes, yeah, I think they put a man
you believe
on the moon.
That?
Yeah.
I believe it.
Yes, you believe it. Good, that's all. That's sort of all at the end of the question, really, but you probably know that quite a lot of people don't believe it.
No.
Yeah, but, well, I sort of believe one thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is, I kind of believe that they might have done some mocked-up fake photographs.
Really? Why?
Because I was someone convinced me of it.
Yeah.
By talking about the angle of light and the shadows on the moon and all that. But then I did an advert with Patrick Moore, and I said, "So, Patrick, did they land on the moon?" And he looked so annoyed with me.
Yeah.
He explained to me how he had helped map the moon for NASA, and he'd spent years on the project, and the landing site was partly his idea, and if I ever spoke to him again, he was going to be sick in my eyes.
They are rather tight. If you'd spoken to Buzz Aldrin, he might have punched you.
I was going to say...
Buzz Aldrin punched someone.
Did he?
He just got so tired of these conspiracy arses.
I think it was a television documentary about...
Well, there have been several, of course.
You know, look at this photo. This couldn't possibly have been taken on the moon. This is obviously taken in a studio.
You're getting me started now, because one gets very sort of strange about this. But there are a lot of conspiracies. 6% of Americans believe that man didn't land on the moon, but 25% of Britons believe that they didn't. So that's a quarter of our nation are not convinced, apparently.
That's so depressing.
Isn't it? It is.
Flag. It's one of its... One of the things I read...
The flag is another thing, yes.
It's a flag. And
yeah, but there it is.
Well, obviously, they've starched the flag because they wanted to get a good photograph of it. They've stiffened the flag.
No, they haven't stiffened it. That's the point. The fact it's like it's rumpled. There's no breath of wind out there, obviously, because you're in space, which is, as it were, a vacuum. But what there is movement. If you impart movement to something, it doesn't stop moving for a long time because there's nothing to... There's no resistance against it. So they unpacked it, unfurled it, put it down, and it moved back and forth. People said, ah, breeze. Ha-ha. As if, A, they would be stupid enough to fake it and allow the tape that had the breeze in it to go out.
But also, if you went to the moon, the least you'd expect is a flag moved a bit strangely. You know what I mean? You're expecting to meet the soup dragon, and you think, OK, he's not there. The flag moves a bit strangely. I can go with that.
Yeah. Why isn't one of them holding up a camera? Because you can see him reflected, the one taking the picture is reflected in the visor of the one, and he's not holding up a camera like that you see. But that's because they didn't, in the visors, put a camera up in front of their visor. They were mounted.
You couldn't really actually imagine them getting a camera out, winding it up.
I'd like to go to the moon.
You would like?
Oh, yeah, I'd like to do that.
Yeah. Two of the other things, just in case people are saying, but you haven't mentioned the clincher. One was the idea that below the lunar module that landed, there was no crater or sense of disturbed dust. The fact is, the engines cut off and it hovered down and it very, very quickly landed. Mm. And unlike in science fiction films, it doesn't send out spears of flame as it descends. That just didn't happen. So,
because it was designed by, you know, human brains and geniuses, and not a lot of people sitting tapping away at the internet who've got to go up to work in the morning.
Yeah,
who do you trust here?
We are in trouble as a species if people refuse to believe in things that they couldn't actually do themselves.
So true. And the other one was the footprints. They said, look, there's too much moisture because look how clear they are. Only a sort of caked mud could do that. But actually, you could do that with flour. The fact is, it's just very fine ground, and it makes... And there's, of course, it's a vacuum again. It coheres. And the other thing with the mirrors that Apollo 12 astronauts put on the moon, which are now used for bouncing lasers off, for detecting, for example, how far the moon is getting away from us. And you can make incredibly accurate measurements because of mirrors on the surface of the moon. And perhaps, to me, the clinching one is that America's enemy at the time in the space race was the Soviet Union. And not once did they make a suggestion that they thought America hadn't done it. Mm. They never said, no, we know this was hoax.
Yeah.
The fact is, for every ill-conceived argument that the moon landings were a hoax, there's a perfectly logical explanation to put our minds at rest. Why did it take 300 years to give the giant tortoise a scientific name?
A scientific name?
Yeah, i.e. the Latin name. It turned out to be called Geocalonia, you know.
Is it because they just thought that was pretty good, giant tortoise?
We'll leave it with that.
Yeah.
I was going to say something about which now it's unusable. I'm going to have to say it.
This better be good.
They thought it was a normal tortoise, but closer is what I was going to say. I couldn't get that concept. It's like, would it be actually further away? And a normal one further away would be actually a minute one. Would they mistake a quite far away normal one for a miniaturised one that's a bit ordinary?
But the thing that you're saying is that the tortoise could be...
If there was like a tortoise over there that was giant, but I for some reason thought it was just there, then I wouldn't think it was giant. I'd think it was just, oh, there's just one there. It was just a normal tortoise there, nothing about that. Oh, my God, it's over there and it's back!
It would have to be on a huge beach with no other points of reference.
Well, yes, exactly.
Yeah, exactly. You
know. Are they...
That's not the reason.
Are they, are they particularly litigious? Now, if you give me a name, I'll sue you.
No, it wasn't that. It's a nice thought to get. No, they had another property which was most unfortunate for them to have.
What, the tortoises did?
Yeah.
They were edible.
They were so edible. Anyone, so, I mean...
Anyone who saw one couldn't stop to think of a name for it. They just had to eat it straight away.
Please, one of those...
Yeah.
Oh, they're cool.
Do you know...
Just get one, though, really.
There's no Latin name for the pistachio now. Exactly the same way. No one can be bothered. Shut up with your Latin. Eat them. They're brilliant.
No Latin name for Maltesers.
None of them made it. It's kind of true. None of them made it to London. None of them made it to Europe.
This time, we're going to take it and we'll take it.
No,
however,
take it back. We'll get it on the ferry coming into Dover. There's a bloke going... leaving the door with a tortoise instead.
You know what?
All right, look, take nine of them. We'll eat eight.
He's become as one tortoise left.
Yeah.
You know. Come on, sir. Come on, we'll go back. Let's just go back and get some more.
Yeah. I'm just imagine the moment after they've eaten that last tortoise. They're sitting there thinking, we are twats.
Even on...
I'm too full.
Even Darwin, on Darwin's last
dozens. There were dozens.
He collected every species in the world. Yeah. He ate that one.
They had them all. They did.
Well, I mean, done all those. Done all the butterflies. Done all the beetles. I'm eating
the
that.
The only descriptions of them are comparing them to chicken, beef, mutton, and butter, and saying they're how much better they are than all of those things. No one who'd ever eaten tortoise had ever eaten anything better.
Why are they not found?
And the liver and the bone marrow, every part of it was unbelievably
delicious.
Whereabouts
are they from?
Well, from the tropics, mostly.
Are there flights over there?
Protected. All
I
12
bet
species.
They're that delicious, they can't be. Well, say, yeah, we're protected and they're all in there. No need to look.
Yeah, they're fine. There's a border around them, like North Korea.
Yeah. There's a big pile of shells, like those piles of tyres you see in a scrapyard.
But there were some that survived, however, and let me tell you about a very extraordinary
that
one.
That bloke there, he's just befriending that one. Yeah, come over here, my pretty. Yeah. I'm trying to think of a name for you.
But they are amazing animals, apart from how delicious they are. Advaita died in 2006, and he was Clive of India's pet. There he is.
Oh, they're 200 years old or something.
255. He was born before Mozart, before the French Revolution, and his death was announced on CNN. I mean, that's a heck of a life, isn't
And you can
it?
List his achievements on the back of a stamp.
Well, why did he need to
Well, his principal achievement is it wasn't...
He lived 255 years. People think probably the oldest living creature because they don't live so long out of captivity like most animals, and he was, you know, well cared for, but that is a pretty astonishing
lifespan. It is quite. So it lived 255 years and is massive. I mean, I've achieved 50% of that. That's great.
There are 12 species of them, all of them endangered. Well,
they
one...
all taste nice?
Well, I don't know, but it's very sad that they have so many were other species were, you know, basically wiped out. Just because they were so lovely. Not only that, they were also used as water stores. It sounds a weird thing, but they have a special kind of internal bladder that stores water so perfectly that it's drinkable. When you slit them open to cook them, you also get, you know, like a gallon of fresh water.
Wow.
So they would stack them up on boats, tons of them. They'd be stacked up, one on the other, and they couldn't move.
And they didn't need to be fed for months, so that they actually contributed a lot to whaling and other things because they were used as a foodstuff and a water supply that was just kind of permanent.
So you've got the water as well. And imagine if you smash the shell open, there's like a little toy in there, like a Kinder egg. Like a little game, you've got to get the balls in the holes.
Yeah. Oh, so how do they exist in the wild anyway, if they're so delicious and slow-moving and massive and useful?
They didn't have any natural predators until man discovered them, basically. Right.
So they were evolutionarily complacent.
They weren't exactly, like a lot of island species, they're a lot like that. And it's only man who crosses islands in the way we do who does it.
All those ridiculous flightless birds on New Zealand.
Yeah.
Essentially, they got lazy.
Yeah.
They got lazy. What's the point of flying? Now, some of them go, we'll need it one day. I bet we'll need it one day. Nah. You're too anal, you are. Just walk around, it's easier.
Yeah. Anyway, despite being discovered in 1535, giant tortoises weren't properly catalogued by science until the early 19th century because they were so delicious that no samples ever...